In this video, we're going to consider the question of when a matrix is diagonalizable. Now, most matrices are diagonalizable, but there are some exceptions. Even if you allow complex eigenvalues and complex eigenvectors, there are some matrices that simply do not admit a basis of eigenvectors. And the space of all n by n matrices, well, that's n squared dimensional. It turns out that the space of non-diagonal n by n matrices is n squared minus 1 dimensional. So if you pick a random matrix, it's almost certain to be diagonalizable. But if you pick a one-parameter family of random matrices, somewhere along the way, there's a good chance that you'll run into a non-diagonalizable one. So let's see how a matrix can fail to be diagonalizable. The standard example is the matrix 1, 0, 0, 1. And let's go find its eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Now, as always, we compute lambda times the identity minus the matrix, lambda minus 1, negative 1, 0, lambda minus 1, and we take its determinant to get the characteristic polynomial. Lambda minus 1 times lambda minus 1 minus negative 1 times 0 just gives us lambda minus 1 squared. And that has one and only one root. So the only eigenvalue is lambda equals 1. Now, only having one eigenvalue isn't necessarily a problem. If we had two eigenvectors with this eigenvalue, great, we'd have a basis of eigenvectors. So let's find out how many eigenvectors we actually have. You have to take A minus lambda times the identity, that's 0, 1, 0, 0, and row reduce it. Now, in this case, there's not much to the row reduction. It already is in reduced row echelon form. The pivot is for the pivot variable is the second variable. The free variable is the first. Our first equation is 0x1 plus x2 is 0. In other words, x1 can be whatever it wants, and x2 has to be 0. And so our eigenvector has to be a multiple of 1, 0. That means that there is only one linearly independent eigenvector. If you take any two eigenvectors, they have to be multiples of each other. And the matrix isn't diagonalizable. So only one eigenvector, that's not enough to form a basis for R2 or C2. And the problem is that one was a double root of the characteristic polynomial, but it only gave us a single eigenvector. In general, we know that the eigenvalues are always the roots of the characteristic polynomial. And this gives us two different ways to decide what the multiplicity of an eigenvalue is. You can say, is it a regular root, or a double root, or a triple root, or quadruple root of the polynomial? That's called the algebraic multiplicity. So if you have a characteristic polynomial that's lambda minus 1 squared times lambda minus 2 cubed times lambda minus 7, we say the algebraic multiplicity of 1 is 2, the algebraic multiplicity of 2 is 3, the algebraic multiplicity of 7 is 1. That's just a regular root. And we denote algebraic multiplicity by M sub A. Now, the geometric multiplicity describes how big the eigenspace is. Now for that, you have to actually figure out what E lambda is, and you do that by taking A minus lambda times the identity and row reducing it. So the geometric multiplicity of 1 is the dimension of E1, and that's going to be N minus the rank of A minus the identity. And MG of 2, because that's the number of free variables. You have this many pivots, this many total variables, so the difference is the number of free variables. Likewise, mg of 2 is n minus the rank of a minus twice the identity. Mg of 7 is going to be n minus the rank of a minus 7 times the identity. Okay. Now, you might ask how are these two different multiplicities related? And the answer is that the geometric multiplicity can never be bigger than the algebraic multiplicity. It's always less than or equal to the algebraic multiplicity. On the other hand, it's always at least one. If lambda is a root of the characteristic polynomial, then there exists an eigenvector. and so the geometric multiplicity is at least 1. Now, in particular, that means if the algebraic multiplicity is 1, then the geometric multiplicity is at least 1, at most 1, so it's just 1. There's nothing to check when the algebraic multiplicity is 1. The only time things get interesting is when the algebraic multiplicity is bigger than 1. Then you have to figure out the geometric multiplicity and figure out, is it 1, 2, 3, or some number up to the algebraic. So the big theorem, this is the theorem that tells us when a matrix is diagonalizable. It's diagonalizable if and only if the geometric multiplicities add up to n. So how do you get a basis of eigenvectors? Well, you take a basis of eigenvectors for each eigenspace, and you just concatenate them. And that's true if and only if, for every eigenvalue, the geometric multiplicity is equal to the algebraic multiplicity. And you only need to check the cases where the algebraic is bigger than 1, because if the algebraic is 1, then the geometric is 1. So for example, look at this matrix here, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. If you work out what the characteristic polynomial is, the determinant of this matrix winds up being lambda minus 1 squared times lambda plus 1. So the eigenvalues are plus and minus 1, and the algebraic multiplicity of negative 1 is 1. The algebraic multiplicity of plus 1 is 2. It's lambda minus plus 1 squared. So this 1 is a double root, so the algebraic multiplicity of 1 is 2. Don't have to worry about the single root. We do have to worry about the double root. So let's figure out what the dimension of the eigenspace is. We have to take a minus 1 times the identity, and there it is. You row reduce it, and you see that there's one pivot. If there's only one pivot, there are two free variables, x1 and x3. And so that means that we have a two-dimensional eigenspace. So in this case, mg is also 2, and we win. It's diagonalizable. In our next example, it's just like the first example, except over here in this corner, instead of putting a 0 here, I've put a 1 there. That doesn't change the characteristic polynomial. The characteristic polynomial still winds up being exactly the same as before. So the algebraic multiplicity of 1 is 2. And now if we go about figuring out the geometric multiplicity, take A minus A identity, and that's this matrix. And to row reduce it, we'll swap the first and third row. Then we'll subtract the second row, add the first row to the second. Now swap the second and third rows. Add the second row to the first. And you see, now we've got two pivots. There are two pivots, so there's only one free variable. So the geometric multiplicity is 1. The geometric multiplicity did not equal the algebraic. This was 1, this was 2, so A is not diagonalizable. And remember, when I say the geometric multiplicity, I mean the geometric multiplicity of 1. There's also a geometric multiplicity of the other eigenvalue. Every eigenvalue has a geometric and an algebraic multiplicity. Last example is just like the second example, except I've changed this 1 to a 2. Now if you compute the characteristic polynomial, it's lambda minus 2 times lambda squared minus 1. So the roots are 1, negative 1, and 2. They all have algebraic multiplicity 1. So they all must have geometric multiplicity 1. So it's diagonalizable. Okay. By the way, all three examples were invertible matrices. People often confuse invertible matrices with diagonalizable matrices. They have nothing to do with each other. You can have invertible matrices that aren't diagonalizable. You can have non-invertible matrices that are diagonalizable. Two completely different concepts.